What's up, peeps? Thanks for joining me. My name is Daymon Warren, and this is Day One Tech. And today, I'm going to be going over the DJI Action 5 action camera. I've had it for over a month now, and I did some things with it. I used it on different shoots. I'm going to go over the settings, what's been working for me, some of the things that were a little challenging, and my experience with it up until this point. So if you're interested in getting this camera or how to do different things, this is the video for you. So the first thing I used is this case. I have a video on it. This is actually a case that I had on my 4, and I like this case because it's nice and solid. This is all metal. It still has the magnetic locks on the side and on the bottom with the quarter on the bottom also. And you got one on the side and one on the top. I have this connection here for my wrist strap. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn it on here and I'm gonna reset this all the way back to factory settings so you can see how I set it up from the beginning. So I'm resetting it all the way back to when I first got it. All right, so we are reset. Now, one of the things, they did have an update for it, firmware update, which allows it to go for a higher bit rate. So the first thing I would say is make sure you update it. And I also like to factory reset my cameras that I use a lot, just to make sure it's got a nice fresh software on it. So first thing is to switch to the SD card. You wanna put the SD card in there, switch it to the SD card. I save the internal memory for backup, but I mainly go with the SD card. It goes through the tutorial, how you switch the different modes. You can actually tap on it. I prefer to tap. Makes it easier. And if you want to switch to different modes, you tap in the corner and then you can scroll or tap for the different modes. Majority of the time that I'm using this, I am in video mode. So I'll go with the first settings that I do right out the box. So after it goes through this tutorial, shows you that you can zoom and everything. Right over here to the side, those are your video settings. I tap on the button that says Pro. All right. The exposure, I'm going to leave it in auto. I'm going to take it down to -3. So that drop it to -3. ISO, I go between 100 and 1600. I don't really want to go over 1600. And what that does is if I go into a dark place, it doesn't make it too grainy. And that's like if I'm just going from outside to inside when I'm vlogging, so I don't have to worry about it, the quality going real bad. And that's for the ISO. Now here's another thing. You tap on the top and it allows you to get access to your shutter speed. I put the shutter speed at 100 to 8,000. And you get these other options in there too. But I go 100 to 8,000. I find that doesn't make it jitter as much if it's a really bright day. White balance, I usually keep that on auto. Color, you have the option for normal or normal 10-bit. Depends on how much color grading you do with it. 8-bit has been working fine for me. I haven't really had any complaints with it. It works fine. Next is the cut is your stabilization. So you have two options for stabilization. You have daily and then you have sport. For vlogging, what I'm doing, I'm walking with it, I'm showing what's going on around me. I keep it in daily. If I were riding a skateboard, a snowboard, or anything like that, I would switch it into sport. But daily works best. And then the adjustments, I put it in custom and I knock these both down to about -1 just to soften it up a little bit. All right. Now, typically, if you don't have the mic set up to it, this option would just say noise reduction. I am using a transmitter because that's how I'm recording my audio right now as a backup. But you have the noise reduction, you can turn it on or off. I keep it off. I do the noise reduction in post. And those are the settings for that. Now I come back out to the camera. When you first turn it on, I don't know why they do this, but it's in 1080 at 30 frames per second. So you're gonna slide up. Right where it says wide, I put that on standard D-warp. That makes it look regular and flat, just like a normal video, so you don't get that bowing at the edges. Then over for rock steady, I turn that to rock steady plus. Rock steady is the stabilization, so when you're holding it in your hand or you have it someplace, it doesn't rock back and forth. It looks nice and steady, like you're almost using a gimbal. There is horizontal balancing and horizon steady. I find it rock steady plus, when I turn it on, it's nice and stable and it does the job. The other ones, when I turned them on, it tended to kind of like find where the level is and then leveled itself out. So and if you're not doing a whole bunch of rocking back and forth and different things, rock steady plus is the way to go. That's what I've been using. All right, next, we're going to change the resolution. 4K 16 by 9. That's your standard widescreen 4K. You always want to be careful because it will say the next one is 4K 4 by 3, which is like kind of like a square. So I go with the 16 by 9. Underneath that is your frames per second. I like to go with 60 frames per second. The reason I go with 60 frames per second, first, if I'm shooting in 60 frames per second and I edit my video at 30, that allows me to slow down. So it might be something that I catch, and at the time I wasn't thinking that I wanted to have it in a slow motion kind of thing. 60 frames gives me that option. And also on a bright day, if I'm shooting at 60, I don't have to worry about the picture getting blown out as much. All right, so once that is all set, I pull down and I'm back to the main screen. All right, so the next thing I set up, where this little person is right over here to the left, tap on that. These are custom modes. So this is a custom mode. And I save a custom mode as soon as I do that. And the reason for this custom mode, this is the settings that I'm going to use the majority of the time. Like 9 times out of 10, when I turn this on, that's the mode I want to be in. And it takes a lot of the guesswork out of it. And you can set up multiple modes. But also remember, whatever you change, including your white balance, your exposure, that all will save to the mode. Your frame rate, so that's why it's so important for me to make sure I have that set. Next is your quick switch. So on the side here is your quick switch. So if you have different modes set up, you can tap that button and it will go through the different modes. So that's the quick switch. Now, you can set which ones show up. And basically, I don't even use it. I don't like to use it because they have the power button and the quick switch button right there. So I might go to turn off and it switches the mode. So it needs at least two. So one of the other things I can do, I have that one set up, I go to another one and I set it up exactly the same thing. So one and two are the same. So I have mode one, mode two, I take off that one. And now, whenever I hit that button, these are the same exact settings for both modes. This is for your brightness. Next one is your cog. Now, snapshot. This is the snapshot. One of the main things about this camera is this snapshot button. So if it's off, and let's say I have it off, and I see something, I get an idea, you press that button, it turns on and starts recording right away. So you can have it set for last settings, or have it set for the different modes. So what I like to do, I'm going to have it set to my default mode, because once again, in my pocket, I go to shoot, I want a consistency through all the different footage that I'm taking. And I learned that the hard way. All right. Next down is the single screen preview. So by default, it will show front screen and the back screen all the time. You can have it where it only shows the back screen. I leave that on because one of the benefits, I can shoot like this and then I can turn it over and shoot what I'm showing you, and I don't have to worry about it. Next is the wireless mic setting. I'm using the wireless mic too. It's set up to it. You can do voice control with this. You can set the languages for voice control, and this also turns it on. I really don't use the voice control, but it is a good option. Depth and altitude, I don't really use that, but that would be if you're diving, skydiving, hiking, or anything. Always on display. Now, always on display is when the camera is on, since this is an OLED screen, it will show how much time you have left or how long it's been recording. And it really doesn't eat up on the battery. So I definitely leave that on. That's a big benefit of the 5 over the 4, is having that. Because there would be times when I was like, oh, am I still recording? Even if the screen's off, with the always on display, you'll always know that the screen is what the camera's doing. Screen off when recording. So this will automatically turn off the screen. So once I hit the record button, it can wait 5 minutes and then turn off the screen, 10 minutes. Depending on what I'm shooting, I leave it at 5 or 10. It comes on default at 5, so I just leave it for now. Built-in mic audio backup. What that does is, so if I have the microphone, like I'm using a mic too, and I'm recording, I can have the internal microphone also record to a separate WAV file. So I'll have the mic in the recording from the microphone I'm using, but whatever the camera's picking up, it will record that as a separate WAV file, which makes it good for like ambient noise or different things. So that's an option. You can turn that on or off. It comes default off. Next is timer shooting. I haven't really messed with it too much, but this is a good option. Let's say if you're doing star lapses or anything, you can set this up and then just have it cut on at a certain time and pick the different modes and when it's going to repeat. So I don't really touch that. USB mode. If you do not select one, what happens is when you plug it into a computer, it's going to give you the option whether you want to use the transfer or if you want to use it as a web camera. It's usually transfer. I just plug the USB right into it and I transfer the footage over. but I will tell you that I like using the app more than transferring it straight over. The reason why I like using the app is because I can file manage a lot easier. It does take a little longer, but being able to know what's been moved over and what hasn't is a lot easier on the app. So if you're interested in the app, I'll be doing a video on that. Okay, wireless connection. I don't really do too much with that. That's the default, and I just leave it exactly where it is. Bitrate. Now, this is new with the update. You have the choice between standard, comes on default, and then you have high. And what high allows you to do is when you're adjusting colors, color grading, or anything like that, with a higher bitrate, it doesn't degrade the picture as much. So if you have a high color bit rate and then you're using this high bit rate, I believe the default standard is around 50, which is good for things like YouTube. But if you're doing something with a little bit, I don't know, of it, you want better quality, you put it in high and then the bit rate turns into, I think it's around 100. So I've been using standard. I've been okay with standard. I haven't really felt the need to go to the higher bit rates yet. It does take up more space, but if you're doing a lot of color grading and changes to your color, high bit rate being an option now is definitely a plus. Sound, that refers to the sound of the clicks. So you have your choice, medium. I like medium. If it's on high and I'm around people, it just sets off their ears like, huh? So next is grid. I like to put my grid on. I just have the regular grid on, and that's for framing. So here I go back to the main. So that puts the checkerboard up. So when I'm framing, I can see how everything's framed, and that's on the front camera as well, on the front screen as well. So I can see how my framing is. Next is time code. I don't really do too much with that. That's for syncing and doing projects. Naming management. You can name the folder and you can name the file. So if you have multiple ones, I like to designate this one as So now all the files that are stored are DA5. So if I have it on the computer or something, it's not trying to name two files the same thing. It just helps with designating the different things. Okay, auto power off. It's set at 5 minutes. So if I haven't touched it in 5 minutes, let's say I just sit it still and I don't move anything, in 5 minutes, you'll hear a beep and then it'll count down and then it'll turn off. 5 minutes is usually pretty good. Your horizon calibration, that's good to, you just sit it flat and it will make sure that it's back to level. It only takes a couple seconds. Now was the calibration. Continue last live stream. You can live stream with this. I don't. Bluetooth remote control, I don't have that. Storage, these are your different storage settings. So I have a 120 gig card in there and it's got the internal 47 gigs. And this is where you can manage its erase format, language, date and time. That syncs up. And then you have your factory reset, which is what I did. Device info and compliance info. Okay. This next one over here, that is your screen orientation lock. So if I turn it, the screen will stay horizontal. If I turn it off and I turn it sideways, let's say I want to shoot some vertical, it will start going like that, so I can throw it into vertical and then it locks in as vertical. I leave it locked in horizontal. This is your screen lock. So when the screen is locked, just in case any accidental touches or anything, you have to swipe up in order to disengage it. Okay, voice control. It allows you one touch to turn it on or off. And this is full front screen display. So there it is. You see the front screen. And then it puts the bars. And that basically makes it so you can see the different settings that you have, because this front screen is touch. So the majority of time for me, I will just keep it on full screen. All right, now there's another page. If you swiped to the side, that's your quick right into your storage. So that's like a little shortcut right there to get into your storage. And that is pretty much all the settings that I use. That will allow me out the box, get ready to shoot. Just set up your quick switch, put your custom mode in there, whatever you think you're going to record at. Some people record at 24 frames, 30, whatever. So that's the quick setup for that. Now, here's a little tip here. Something I found out, it was kind of hard way, because they talk about the super slow mode that it does, adding frames and everything. So I thought in order to get to it, you had to go all the way over and it says slow motion. That is not correct. This is the standard slow motion. You can do 1080, you know, go 4K, 120 frames, but that is not the super slow mode that they're talking about. The super slow mode, in order to get to that, what you need to do is go into your regular shooting mode. All right, so I'm gonna go right back to my first mode. See how easy that is? And you have to shoot either 100 or 120 frames per second. And what happens with that? So records that, I just recorded that at 100 frames per second. All right, now, as you can see on this screen, there's a little snail right there. And that is how you get into your slow motion. So we got 20 seconds on here now. Going to the playback. And there you go. You hit the little snail and it does all the processing inside of the camera. And it will say generating super slow motion video clip. And while it's processing, you can hit the preview. And there you go. That is how you access the super slow motion. Whatever mode you're shooting in the video, you want it over 100 frames per second. Once the system sees that you're shooting over 100 frames per second, if you do the playback, it will give you that option and you can slow it down and it will make it look nice and smooth. And if you don't like it, there's a little trash can at the corner. You hit that and it will delete it. Or you can save it. And then when you look at the file, you see how there's a little blue spot right there? That's where the slow motion happened at. took me a while to find that one. Okay. But those are my quick tips on getting this up and running. If you're doing vlogging, I'll go over the app in another video. But those are my tips. That's the way I set it up. As you see, it was nice, easy. I set it up nice and fast. So if you have any questions, hit me up in the comments. Thanks for watching this video. Hey, hit that like button for me. And until next video, remember, take care of each other. Peace out, and I will see you all soon.